tonight to a special game of Shadowdaze Curse of Strahd. As you can see, we have two players, and this is a nice special two-player session. And in that, I kind of like this. We get some real personal time with characters that we've been sharing this journey with for a long time. Tonight it will be Jason who's playing Nihilus, the drow warlock, and Colin, who plays Ellen, the half-elf sorcerer. Both have been through a great ordeal, and they do side with the Fangs, as we call them, who are not necessarily evil, but to their means, to get to their goals, they have found it to be more of an opportunity to get out of Barovia safe, to side with Strahd, which is rarely an option. And so they have taken that. And this is where we find themselves, where they started at a party or grew to a party around 5 or 6. They are now 2. We will go ahead and start tonight's episode. I should see that, and hopefully you will hear sound.
I know I am not made in your likeness. You're not made for my darkness. I know I get lost in the process. I do try, but I'm hopeless.
Back to Shadowdaze. Tonight's episode 17.5, and then there were 2. We will go ahead and pick up. Moments have passed after the shocking of witnessing the shocking death of one of their members, and then watching the vampire Creus being destroyed at the hands of Argenvoss the dragon. Hiding and invisible, they also watched a new party member, I don't know if they feel if it's betrayal, but literally leave with Argenvoss and the other party. This leaves our sorcerer and our warlock together alone, but definitely wounded or tired. But and having had these transformations to their body from the gifts or the curse, depending on how they look at it, that were bestowed upon them at the Amber Temple. Now, miles away, Mount Gaucus still flares red like a volcano, though we don't see any necessary magma. Seems to be like the top of the mountain is just blown off, and a haze of mist rides around that entire section. They still stand in the swampy woods of Berez. They have, within the last hour, we'll say, have been traveling and met with, they heard some flapping as this huge creature they saw come out of the sky. They probably prepared themselves for a battle to try or even try to hide. The creature seemed to know exactly where you were all at, and it lands. Looks with a pink, flared nostrils and jowls that kind of drop down to have these mandibles on the end. This huge gray leathery bat creature with not much hair, maybe little puffs here and there, is being ridden by this very flamboyant figure in like a burgundy outfit, frilly white shirt, puffs from both sides, and a monocle, his blonde hair streaking back. Bit of a dirtiness to his clothing, though, almost like he climbed out of soil. But he doesn't treat it that way. He doesn't act that way. A pistol on his hip and a long rifle strewn across his back. He looks around and introduces himself Hello, wherever you guys are hiding or whatever you're doing, I can see you there. Fate Argo. A confidant. I've been sent by Strahd, and you all look so muddy. You definitely need a good bath. Come with me. Hop on. Let's go.
Fate.
I know yes.
You. You didn't. I guess you don't even recognize me. What are you doing here?
Give me an insight check as you look at Fate, too.
My insight. 19.
Nice. So upon, as you're confused, as you realize, like, why doesn't he, like, recognize me? As you even think that and you ask him that, Ellen, what you know deep down inside, what it kind of starts to settle, you start to realize is that not that you really know the ins and outs or the histories of vampires or vampire spawn, but whatever this thing is, it talks like fate, it walks like fate, but you have a good feeling it's not, it's kind of puppeting, it's mimicking him. But to all intents and purposes, you do feel like it's his body, like it's him resurrected, but whatever is in housing that body is no longer Fate Argo.
I will approach cautiously.
Do not worry, I will not hurt you. You all, this would make a fine picture if you didn't look so dirty, but come on.
Sometimes it's best for paintings to be true to life.
Ah, this is true. Can't say I'm even that good at it, but I try.
I think you underestimate yourself. Nihilus, I know him. This is curious why he's here, but it appears he's connected with Strahd.
Yeah, pick that up from the bat. So do we go?
It's an easy ride. We have news, but I imagine Strahd has news for us, too.
What is this news that you have?
Well, we met a party that is opposing him, that's preparing to try to destroy him.
Oh, the poor feathers.
Yeah.
Boy, did they underestimate Lord Strahd. The first group did. Now I have this shiny new vessel. News as well. But what else did you? You seem to hesitate. Fine, sir. Is there something else I should know about?
Well, yes, there were fewer of us, you might notice, than there were before. They managed to kill Kratos.
The vampire fellow. Oh.
His remains are back there.
That's unfortunate. One of our own has fallen. It is okay.
Seemed he had terrible luck. He was falling a lot in fights, but doesn't mean he wasn't strong.
I'm sure he was. I did not know the man. But as you say, I'm sure he was.
And the newcomer who was with us, Quake, he didn't fall. He went with the others.
Traitors will be dealt with. He kind of like turns. He's like straddling this thing, kind of like turns, and it has like a bridle, and you know, he pulls the reins, kind of like moves around a bit, walking on its kind of like the knuckles of its hands with the wings back. Well, we can sit in this murky swamp all day. I mean, you seem like you've seen a ghost. Traitors will be traitors, but is there anything else?
We thought you might know already what happened to Fido.
Yes, the bones crashed, and I'm sure I'd find them back there. Strahd knows the dragon is finally at rest.
No? Yes, and was that Nihilus?
The dragon is not resting. Right. Dragon is up and healthy. Did you not know?
I did not. The dragon is alive? How could that be? Rod made no necromancy on it after it died the second time, of course.
That was the betrayal. It was Quake.
Power from the Amber Temple?
Correct.
Where have they gone?
Well, you can imagine that was Argenvost. He went home.
The direction. Argenvost, for sure.
Mordstrahd should know about this immediately. You can come with me, but I will definitely... I would like to do a fly over the area to make sure and confirm you speak the truth, so that I can report this as truthfully to Lord Strahd. Not that I distrust you. Is that fine with you? Do you want to stay here or continue on foot until I take a look around? Or would you like to come with?
I think we'll travel faster on the wing. Nylas, are you all right with that?
Yeah, I'm fine with the whatever. We might need to make a small pit stop.
What do you need, sir? You look quite pale there. I know I typically need a refreshing a few times a day. I usually stop into Valaki. They're still good. Good source of good source of vitamins and minerals.
Sustenance.
Perfect word.
I may require slightly different sustenance than your kind. You know of a nice fresh graveyard anywhere near here?
That I can... well... And while something else embodies this thing, it may not know everything, and it also is, if it may inhabit some of the qualities, it may inhabit some of the memories of fate. Fate's never been to all of the graveyards around, and so it thinks for a second. I'm gonna give it a DC wisdom, just 12. I'm sorry, Fine, sir. Maybe you know of some place, but we probably should make haste. There's plenty of dirt at Ravenloft. Do you need it? It'll probably take us now at this time. If I can push this beast, should be able to get there in 30, 40 minutes.
Yeah, that's fine. I probably have another few hours before the hunger's too much to bear.
We'll have to talk about that, Nihilus.
I mean, an animal will work too, but I just don't think we have time to hunt.
I can give you time if you need it, but you let me.
I think traveling quickly, moving with haste seems...
Sounds like we need to go, yes.
So you find a way to hop on and gather yourselves and you sit behind him. No necessary particular order. And that creature begins to lift off the ground. And for the second time in a day now, you are riding another creature, much smaller. And so the wind bristles a lot more. You feel less confident on this thing than you did on Argenvoss's bones. And even more, the wind kind of tears at you and rattles this thing back and forth like a kite. You can tell that the wind has started to move more in Barovia. There's more distant thunder and crackling, as almost like a storm is brewing. And, you know, not moments later, but over the time, eventually the clouds and the mists begin to part and you see the castle looming before you on that high edifice, that rock, almost like a demonic hand that holds it aloft, showing it off to all of Barovia as to say, no, don't fuck with me. And as you close in, he actually swoops down and there is a large tower that you begin to see. I'm just looking at your notes. I was just making sure there was some. Oh, yes. And so in between that time, you did make a quick scout around Argenvossold. And what you're able to see as you went there is saw moments of the feathers kind of walking. There's a moment, you know, the first kind of couple of fly arounds, you could see people on the ground. It appears to be the feathers. You guys clearly identify them. And then another fellow, no dragon, but another man that they were talking to in full regalia, full knight armor, in a very shiny silver. And then out walk momentarily two other silver knights, but they look aged and old, decrepit and undead. And there seems to be talking and conversation going. And Fate is smart. He's able to stay at a high altitude and loom amongst the shadows. And at one moment, the man in the shiny armor glows bright. And the minute Fate sees it, he sees his silhouette transforming, similar to what you saw, but becoming gargantuan and huge. And that is all that he needs to see as he begins to dive high above the clouds, knowing that if that dragon takes to the sky, he might spot you. And so that was a moment that you had earlier on. And so then you arrive at Ravenloft. And, you know, Fate is like, do you want the full tour? Would you like to go through the drawbridge? Or do you like to come in? I sometimes like to land on the towers. How about you? I mean, I think you've never been a guest, so I'd let you know, you can decide how grandly you'd like to tour Ravenloft.
Seems to me the grand tour would start at the top.
The top it is. Instead of taking you to the highest peak, there are three towers. And he goes, the top is the way to go, but to get there, we must go. And he goes to the middle tower and lands. As he lands on this kind of parapet, there's a walkway extending. And actually, what I would go ahead and do is, if you guys are logged, you're in roll 20. You see me pointing. He lands you here. And what I'll also share with you, Phil and Jason Zoom tried to, as definitely sabotage me, because I had a bunch of images that I could easily throw up behind me, but instead what I will do, they're no longer there for some reason. So what I will do is show them to you in Roll 20 and do that kind of share with players thing. Mm-hmm. So I'm gonna share this as you approach. Do you see that?
Yep.
Okay, so that gives you a good understanding of what the castle looks like from the side. I like to imagine, I definitely am more dramatic in imagining that Ravenloft has all these different towers and is a little bit more dramatic like the one behind me. But for all intents and purposes, that is the structure down to a T. This is the, that first one, the lowest one is the one he lands on with the walkway going across. It, as you get in, the rain clouds and the mist around, it begins to rain. And you can clearly see from that image as well that from the rock that Ravenloft sits on is about 1,000-foot drop, and then the structure itself is about 360 feet high. So you guys are very high up, and as you land, the winds kind of rush across, almost tempting to push you over edge as you walk across that area. But you make it. And then... as you get into the, you walk into from, if you're looking on Rule 20, from this area, he leads you across into this hall here. And what you see is, you are all, as you walk across there, you end up in this huge open space that drops hundreds of feet down below, but there's a spiral staircase, a landing that you can take continuously going up. And as you continue up, there are no railings on this casing, and there is a reddish glow coming from above, and then you start to hear the boom, 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 the thumping of a heart. And as you get almost to this next level, like you, when you get another 50 feet up, walking very carefully around the outer edges of the space, you see a crystal shaped, a red crystal shaped like a heart, glowing and bumping and creating that red hue. And you, every now and then, blue light crackles or green light crackles around it as they'll connect it to it. And you continue to go upward. And as you get to the top landing, you enter what further. When you finally get to the top together, you enter a room. And inside that room, there are runes all on the glyphs on the floor, carved into the floor, and they're all glowing green. And there is this triangular pattern, and there are these three spots that are lighting the majority, like lighting very bright with this kind of emerald glow. And it seems to be like some rituals taking place, but almost like Strahd is taking a break, almost like it's still working. And he sits in a chair in the corner. There are a couple of sconces lit, and at the back of the room, you can see that his regal armor, the armor that murdered the first feathers, is sitting there, standing in the corner. And he's has his head kind of down and clutched, and he looks up. His hair, it's not neatly kept. It's kind of stringy and all into his face. Where are the rest of you?
This is it. We shared our news with fate. We've lost Kreas. Quake has joined the feathers.
That is unfortunate. Well, not all is lost. But it is good to see you.
You look like you've been busy.
I have.
We are sorry to report that when Fido did go down, we also lost track of the wand.
You see. That, and then as you say that, he goes, this wand, and then he leans and throws his cloak back, and he has it leaning against a wall within like half a foot of him, and he grabs it, and he goes, I am the one that should apologize to you. I saw that happen. I was there in Brez. I had to seize the opportunity, and I could not reveal myself, you understand. And that's why I sent fate to come and get you. I knew that you would be resourceful and that you would be well. But I'm sorry that the dragon is no more. And then fate kind of bows and says, well, kind of looks at you like, are you going to tell him or should I? Lord Strahd, we should talk about this. The dragon, about that, they have reported the defector, the other, the Quake, used the power of the Amber Temple to restore Argenvoss to totality. And then he just like kind of like drops his head into his hand. Bellows out a large like yell, frustrated. Slams the staff down. No matter, it is fine. Because in hours from now, less than a day, I will be gone from here and Argenvoss can have this place. And if you all work with me, we can all be gone. Speaking of that, no use crying over spilled milk. Come with me, shall you? Shall we? And he starts to lead you through the castle, down the stairs, spiraling. Time goes on. And during this time, while he's taking you there, he's very quiet, but he's like, come with me. So if there are any, if you guys want to talk or ask him any questions while he's leading you to wherever you're going, as you walk through this kind of magnificent but also decrepit, very old castle, constantly hearing things call out to you from the quiet areas and moanings and creaks going on. I'll turn it over to you guys if there's anything that you're doing while you're walking.
Obviously, Argenvast is going to be a problem. I think the more that we know about him, the easier it will make to defend from him. Can you tell us more about maybe if he has any weaknesses or anything that can be exploited against him?
Argenvoss is a silver dragon. You have dragons where you come from, no?
Of course. I think there are dragons everywhere.
The silver dragons. Think that they are... consider themselves good. They... Argenvoss was the such. His armies had moved into this valley when I was conquering. I believe he was trying to protect the secrets of the Ember Temple. And of course I wanted them. And as I conquered, our war fueled like a bright flame. And as you walk down the stairs, one of the sconces light fires up from Strahd clutching his fist and goes back to a flickering flame. And he said he was a very tough foe. But of course, and kind of head high, no match for me. I destroyed him, cut him into little pieces. For a while, I kept him in different parts. Then I thought, what's the fun in that? Sometimes I didn't like casting spells or riding sometimes on my steed. And so I brought him back. He was a terror. And called him Fido for the shits of it. But, fuck it, he's back. That's fine. Let them all come. Like I said, they underestimate me way too often. What else do you want to know about a losing dragon that died, that loves humans?
Seems to be all that needs to be said. He'll consort, or not consort, he will aid humans. Yeah. While many dragons do not.
Yes. They are great. He is powerful. I'm sure I'm not excited or happy to hear that he is back. Do you just see black on roll 20?
Yes.
Yeah. So let me, I didn't put, that's my fault for him. Let me get a, and so he takes you into this very dark crypt. And where did I leave our? And it is expansive. It's probably the, I want to say it feels like the, I'm trying to describe, it's like the entire basement. After you go down several levels, the width of the castle and whatever that is, this entire room is just crypt after crypt after crypt and stone. And at this point, you're starting to feel that hunger and that, and you haven't got no dirt or no bones yet, and you're starting to like, I don't know if it smells good or if you feel it. How might you be reacting, that knowing that all this death and all this, it's around you right now.
Strahd, are any of these graves perhaps expendable?
What do you need?
as you can see, I've undergone some changes, and it appears that I have a craving for some of that dirt over there, or maybe a nice tasty femur.
Give me one second. He walks over to walks into one of the crypts, and that one of them that's open, it seems like it's been freshly prepared in there. There hasn't been a body put in there, but there's a coffin, and there's fresh dirt in it. He walks in there and he kind of pulls a hunk of it, and he just sprinkles some in your hand. And then there's a skeleton like at the front, like laying down like a guard. It begins to breathe and come to life. And as it like stands up in front of you, almost like to attack, Strahd takes like his pinky finger. It's like a long kind of pimp nail. He just like claws across the back. I know she said that. It just like very lightly slices across the back of that skeleton, almost like short-circuiting whatever power, and it just collapses over, and he goes, "Feast, my friend. Have whatever you need."
I kind of turn in a different direction, but gag a little bit.
Just dirt.
You're eating dirt.
Okay, do you see it lighting now? As you maybe back away? Back away from the... You see anything? No, you don't see me moving this. Nothing around. Should be casting light. That's interesting. I so need Nick to make sure I'm I have vision on. I have... dynamic lighting. That's weird that you guys don't see anything.
Do we need to have our tokens on the screen?
I just put a token on there, and it's the same token I usually use for you, so I thought you guys would all be able to see it. I just use the token that I always use for you, the bat token. And I have the invitees. I have, like, you guys should all be able to see it unless I'm running.
And none of that's on the DM layer. It's all on our layer.
Let me make sure it's not on the... Let's see, make sure I'm... That's a good call. Let me make sure I'm not running this on the DM layer. No, I'm running on the objects layer. And it is it's a pretty large space, so make sure you're back out. If not, then I will figure out when we take a break, because I don't want to slow this. It's not super important. It's not like we're fighting right now. I'll share some pictures of it, but I don't want to slow things down. But I'll end up sharing it with you. And so... It's just a huge, it's like crypt after crypt after crypt in this large hall. And then he walks you over to another, and inside of there, he kind of walks in, and the coffin is closed on it, and Strahd waves his, kind of moves his hand slightly, and the coffin begins to kind of slide off, and there's a mist of an air. And as he does it, as it moves, creep, boom, the stone falls down. And inside of there, you see a body, a familiar form, slowly in the dirt, like worms, like going in and out of it, but it like slowly putting itself back together, the skin becoming renewed and fresh again. And then he slowly begins to rise, Creus lying there.
Good thing I fed before we got here.
Welcome back, Creus.
What did I miss?
I'll let them fill you in. You probably don't even understand why you are here. But when vampires are created in my land, I keep these crypts with soil, fresh soil from every land here in Barovia, so that if you do die early, that essence can be ushered back and renewed. Looks like he didn't stake your heart, which is, so you're fine. Of course, if you would have had a coffin or a resting place, it's your first time going through it, I'm sure it was an interesting experience. if you're up in, if your coffin was there, then that's probably where you would have renewed. But welcome home, Sir Creus.
Are we in Ravenloft?
Indeed.
And those stupid bastard birds, where are they?
Apparently in Argenvost Holt.
With Quake.
By the way, can you hear music? Is it too low? Is it too loud? Is it okay?
Music's pretty good.
Okay.
Yeah. I might actually, Renee, you might need to turn your volume up a little bit.
Okay, yeah, I thought Renee was a little low. Maybe turn your gain up a little bit.
What's that?
That's good.
That's better, yeah.
Yeah, better.
So
he's been you've been resting for a bit. I gave a little touch to speed up the normal process. Normally, you might need to lay in there a little hours longer.
But the dragon is coming.
Yeah, you're late to that. They already told me.
This is not good. What of the wand?
Strahd has it.
And he kind of reveals it. You see, I am the master of death now. I am not worried about Orcus, though I know he's coming. And I know when he does show up, he will come for his wand. But I think we could use that to our advantage.
Well, it seems like everyone is going to be coming here then.
This is true. Orcus will be strong, but he's in a weakened state. I've been studying him for a while. And you get the feeling that Strahd has this somewhere in his tons of books, and he's constantly master wizard. And so he knows that this Orcus is no joke. Nothing to even really toy with, but he also knows if they're all going to come to him, and if Orcus is going to come to him, then maybe we pit Orcus against our enemy. He will also be in a weakened state. You see, Orcus is a demon lord. He is no god. He has taken many forms over the millennia, and from the smallest to what only the latest recordings say he is a Baelor, but the Demon Lord version. The problem is, what's last noted, what I was able to confirm through some dark arts and talking with spirits outside of Barovia, is that Orcus died recently, and he was defeated by the Demogorgon. So, when an abyssal spirit is being slowly but surely resurrected, they never come back full powerful. They'll need that time to, he'll need time to rest, but I doubt he will. He'll know his wand is close, and I'll use that against him.
I have a concern. If Orcus is able to come here, and the forces of the Raven Queen can arrive as well, what is going to keep her from interfering with us even further? She is a god. If she can come here or extend her reach here, it could be very bad.
She wishes she was a god. Don't believe everything they tell you, Ellen. The zealots are quite idiotic in their thinking, and it will get them killed. She is one of the closest powers to a god, but I do not fear her like I fear other dark powers. And so, yes, you are You are correct to be concerned, but so far she has only been able to meddle through her pesky followers. And I don't think she would risk being destroyed by bringing her own essence in to my domain. And I think Orcus is definitely going to muddy her plans a bit.
What if you were to offer her the wand and strike her down? Is it a possibility, Lord Strahd?
You see, I need the wand. I'm still conducting... I should probably tell you what is really happening here. And suddenly for the first time, I know Ellen and Nihilus have been spending some time with him, but he takes a step and he kind of... And he drops his cloak over and he clutches aside and he keeps one of his cloak kind of over, like, you know, whereas he normally kind of have it flowing. He feels like he's like hiding something. And he staggers a bit like he's in pain. And he stops, he gathers himself and he goes, I just need to leave here. And his eyes kind of swell for a bit. And I just need to complete the ritual upstairs in the tower. And so he's harkening back to that room that you guys are just in, the one that's actually being showed there that Ellen and Nihilus got to see, that those glyphs on the ground, the wand and the three gems, the seeds of Barovia are all a part of the ritual. Honestly, that is where you all come into play. For the first time ever, I will be honest in that when they come, I will be momentarily without all of my strength because I will need to focus on completing the ritual. It is draining me so all, I've been trying to complete it in one fell swoop, but even I need to rest in between. And you kind of get the feeling that this is a resting moment for him. He knows that he needs to go back in like the next 6 or 7, 8 hours and get right back on it. When it is complete, Ravenloft becomes my freedom. Let's just say that the seeds of Ravenloft together give me enough power, and the wand itself is enough of power of death to push the Raven Queen's and the dark hold on this land to create the opening, and the seeds are enough to propel with my arcane machinery that I've developed over time to move the castle into another plane. Now I will need to concentrate because I know what plane, I know where I plan to go with it. Do you all want to go with me?
Well, I certainly don't want to stay here.
The material plane is my plan. So, Creus, we've talked before. Do you still want my land knowing that Orcus now threatens it?
To kill the Raven Queen's soldiers would be a mighty thing. But to kill the god of death would be even better.
Kind of like cracks a smile, like, you never fail to, see a little bit of myself in you. And even there, he's like, he's such a narcissist, he's like, he looks at everything like, and he's proud of himself at just looking at you in that moment. Fair. It can be done. Well, what else can I You all look like you need some rest. I have fate preparing a banquet or food, and not that Creus or I will need it, but food for the rest of you.
It'd be nice to have an actual hot meal in some place that's safe.
My God, I'm undead, but geez, the fucking no eyeballs and the slack face. You should probably visit my wizards. I mean, my witches. He tells you what floor and what place where to go. They might be able to fix that for you, so you can keep the power, but still look dignified.
And Chris starts to look around. He starts to look around and he realizes for the first time, he's like, my sword, where's my those bastards? Very well. Lord Strahd, I'm assuming you have weapons for me.
Everything you had before, I will be able to give you.
Excellent.
It will not be the same gear, but I can equip you to where you feel comfortable. And though you will realize, as a vampire, you are always well equipped for your enemies.
And what of Quake? Any word?
He just spits on the ground.
What did you think he did? He brought back Argenvost, and he went with them.
And then suddenly, can I get a dexterity? Because you feel it, like your spidey senses tingle, Creus. Can you give me a dexterity save? You need to beat a 25. DC 25.
It's going to be... oof, just short.
Oof. So you feel something slam against your jaw, and you realize it's Strahd's thumb and his index fingers crushing on down on your jaw, locking them shut. He says, do not speak his fucking name again. And then he like caresses your jaw and like brings down, you feel the claws kind of run. He kind of gathers himself.
Traitor, so are
not to be spoken of.
Anymore. Very well. So our compatriot is now an enemy. One more name to the list.
One more name to the list. Listen, I should probably leave you. And you walk with him, and I'll say that what he does is he walks you back to the tower you see up here, and so I'll add Creus now. So you all end up where you started, back in that room above. Strahd sits down, and he clutches his side, and strange to see Strahd in pain, like he's not healing from whatever wound he has. Listen, you are guests of mine. Take those stairs, go down all the way to the bottom. You will find in the main foyer a room decked out with fine foods if you need to eat and rest. Also, feel free to walk the castle in your time as you rest. And what I'm pretty much saying here is that you guys are taking your long rest even during this conversation that you've been having with Strahd. And it's probably been an hour now. And so you've got 7 hours, even more, to just chill. But he is also inviting you to explore the castle, if you'd like. Ask him. He needs his time. He lets you know that he is about to prepare to start casting his ritual again. He does let you know that not all parts of the castle, even though he has already cast enough, his presence will let certain creatures know that you are not a threat. Not everything in the castle may know that. So certain areas may still be threatening. But for the most part, all traps and most of his denizens will see you as friendly. And he kind of waves, like, leave me be. And so I turn it over to you.
Does he have a servant that could possibly act as kind of a guide? Or It's just
fate should be downstairs in that banquet room if you'd like to, and fate would be able to guide you if need be. I don't know if Kreis knows about that. So you guys can let him know once he or.
I was going to mention it. So, yes, yeah, so if we're heading down that way,
mm-hmm.
I'll also take Kreis aside. I'm like, I have a concern.
Yes, Ellen.
You remember your past, right? From before you changed into a vampire? It's clear to you?
Yes. I came here from Eberron. I escaped the lich who lied, Lady Ilmero. I remember taking an airship.
As you guys are walking down, suddenly Strahd appears on the staircase. He goes, one last thing. I will need you at some point. I would want to reconvene at some point, and you will know. I will send for you at that time. And then he goes up in mist. Just interrupting your conversation, he's gone again.
I want to be able to do that, Ellen.
Don't we all? No,
but, why are you at? Do you not recall what?
I do. My concern, and you'll meet this person. There's among Strahd's retinue, there's someone called Fate. And I knew him in White Sparrow. We don't know why he's here now, but he's one of Strahd's vampires. And he didn't recognize me. But he's very obviously that same person. He has the same mannerisms, the same. He's dressed the same, although he's dirty, which he never would have been in life. I was just concerned for you that you might be in a similar, not quite there, state.
I feel, well, actually I don't feel, I feel cold, if you could call it that, but my memories are still intact. Perhaps this fate did something he shouldn't have.
I imagine he did. He was not always wise.
Well then.
But you'll meet him soon. You'll see what I mean.
Very well.
Continue to roleplay also. So I imagine, because what I want to do is I want to fix so that if you do want to explore the castle, I want you guys to be able to see the castle itself. So I'm going to work on that momentarily. But as you do walk into that banquet hall, you come down a large set of stairs, and Fate is standing there, and he goes, "Did you guys? I had Strahd told me to be here. Are you hungry, or are you interested in just some leisure activity, or?" I'm here to. He Strahd. Lord Strahd told me that you wanted a guide, and so I am here for you if you need anything. I also don't want to be looking over your shoulder, but if you need anything, I'll be out of the way.
Armory.
The armory. Yes. I can get that set for you. Let me go. Make sure it is ready, and I'll be back momentarily to usher you there. Anyone else?
Fate, is it?
Fate it is.
May I ask you something?
Yes.
Fate, how long have you been here?
To my recollection, several days. But not even a week.
Very well. You may go.
Fair enough. Do you touch him at all, or?
No.
Okay.
And Fate, I don't think I'm going to sit down for a full meal, but you could point me towards the kitchen. Maybe I'll grab an apple or something. Has been a long time since I ate.
And so, not going to... Well, everything is... The food is... pre-made. There's plenty of apples in there. Do you want to? And so he guides you And then as he opens these two wide doors, this is more or less more metagamey, or for the players, it's the same room from the wedding episode, if you can remember that, where the feathers were there. It's the same room, the food is set and laid out, the organ is high on a pedestal at the opposite end of the room. And there are, for momentarily as the doors open, you see like a ghostly presence of people like waltzing for a moment. You see waiters serving food and then they slowly vanish and the room goes from being like very majestic to kind of the decrepit place it is now. That organ plays, but it almost seems distant because like it doesn't seem like there's no one there playing it now, but it doesn't, the sound seems a bit distant and not kind of in your face like it should be. And the food smells good, looks good. There's plenty of wine. For Creus, we immediately know it's not blood. I will go prepare that armory for you, Trius.
Thank you, Fate. I will be with Ellen and Nihilus.
I guess as long as we're waiting, I'll sit down and actually eat something.
And so I'll grab like a turkey leg or something that looks nice and mobile and a goblet of wine.
Creus will take a goblet of wine and just to see if he can taste anything, try and taste it. Oh well, worth a try. Now, and he kind of looks around. What the hell happened when I was shattered?
What more do you want to know? The others left, the dragon stomped on you. They flew away. Fate came and found us on a winged bat creature.
Advantage wisdom check from Creus.
Net 20.
Nice. And so you hear Ellen giving you the responses. You hear him telling you, and then like you settle as deep down, you almost outside of yourself see what happened, and you realize for the first time as a vampire, you know that when you now drop to zero, when you die, you don't death save, you know, metagame, or you don't death save, or you don't anything, your body just fades and it turns into a mist. Maybe Argenvoss had forgotten that, or maybe he never knew since he never killed the official Strahd. And that mist journeys to the soil or the area where you die. But it needs to be a contained space. Usually a vampire has a coffin, but what happens to the first vampire who doesn't know where their coffin is? The person who never had a coffin. And so in that way, it's almost the way Strahd has his lower crypt set up so that he can, it's almost like a little incubation to deposit. So he had enough soil from the heel, from the Amber Temple area, that your spirit would go back to. So if, let's say if you had died in Valaki, you would have probably gone to one of his crypts where the soil was from Valaki. And so they are closed in, your body begin to repurpose, remanifest. And so now if you ever die, that is your coffin. That's where you go. That is.
So this is what happens next. Now, I don't know if he's listening or not, but what are we going to do about him? He's obviously going to leave. And I don't think he'll be able to leave before Orcus arrives.
Sounds like he's counting on luring Orcus here.
I have a bad feeling of this.
Yes, everyone is converging on this point.
Which means if Orcus is going to come, so will the Raven Queen. Now, if we could somehow manage to get them to fight each other, then perhaps the two of you can slip away. I made my word with you both. I will see to it that you get out. I have no intentions of leaving, no matter who is here. But I do want that fucking dragon's head. And if he thought Strahd was horrible and kept him as a Dracolich, I'm gonna mount his head anywhere I find a place.
What do you... You're gonna stay here and fight all of these things?
Ellen, where I come from, there's nothing left. Nothing. I would rather remain here, where there is constant war, than go back where I was and be a slave to someone who lied.
I just have a hard time understanding, but if those are your wishes, then I certainly appreciate you staying true to your word.
I only wish we had Garruk.
That's going to make things difficult. Well, Nihlus, what... I mean, you came here... Oh, no, you didn't come here for a reason. Are you even still looking for something here? Or is it just... you just want to leave like I do?
I left. I would love to just leave. If that's... Now it stops and looks around if that's going to be a possibility. But it's also possible that I have a mission to complete still.
Yeah, you haven't heard from your friend. I don't think he can speak to you here.
We shall see.
Well, I certainly, I don't know what rules there are as far as Strahd's witches that he mentioned that could do something about this. That's what they sound like.
I could fix this. It's the mm-hmm. I need them to do something about. We won't. But I would like to stop by the witches if possible.
I think I'd like to talk to Irina too. She's supposed to be here somewhere.
So should we do this in order or should we split up?
Well, Kreas, you have an errand in the armory. Nihlus and I have an errand with the witches.
We meet back here in, say, an hour's time?
It takes an hour. I mean, the castle's probably small enough that I'll be able to send you a message if necessary.
Yes, very much so. Okay. Can you actually see, just this is me asking a question, if can you see your token here in the room where I moved you guys all to? Still don't see.
Oh, black screen.
Yes. Why is that the case? Okay. So what I will say is I'll try to work on that while we'll take a break soon so I can work on that. Because I think I have a couple more things I can try. But while you're sitting there deciding to split up, and Fate walks in and sees you guys maybe milling about, picking at the... is the food you're liking? Not eating much, it seems.
Bird is good.
Okay.
No, I've been actually eating.
Fair. Good, good, good. Just want to make sure you're happy. Kreas, the armory is prepared. The rest of you, anything else you need?
We were going to go up and see the witches.
Ah, the witches. Yes, the tower where we landed, or a couple stairs down, is where they brew their cauldron. Strahd did mention you would need to see them, so fair enough. Let us go. And as you all follow Fate, it starts to point you in the right directions. We kind of fade to black on that scene. And a scene that I probably would have shared as an opening to today's game, but now that Krius is here, you kind of go back in time to moments after the crash, after Fido bit it, after that dragon's bones separated in multiple pieces and you all were gathering yourself. There were a moment there in that tense conversation as you were all, I think, dealing with the feathers, not knowing what was going to happen next. And looking back on it, maybe thinking back on it now, you all know that Garrick seemed a bit quiet. You know, he probably would have leapt into battle and cleaved someone down. But in that conversation, in that moment, it was probably the most quiet he ever been. He had taken a back seat. And what you all didn't see was during that conversation, his internal battle was coming to a resolve. To some degree, the characters would never know this, but the players, to kind of share with them, Garrick was starting to experience the fact that that weight of that curse had been lifted. He no longer really needed to find himself drudging through the swamps of Berez. And being a planeswalker, he began feeling enlightened. And part of him knew that you were all in danger. He wanted to help. And there was the Garrick, the planeswalker, the one who had come from lands of beautiful jungles and awesome beasts that was calling to him. And whether on purpose or not, the moment he decided to leap into battle to help you, the mist enveloped, the mist seemed to become so dark with every step that he took. And then he realized he was planeswalking. He was moving back, and as he swung his blade, as it slammed down, he was back in the jungle somewhere else. Barovia had almost kicked him out, pushed him back. He no longer fit, he no longer fit in. So as he looks up, nods his hat, his helmet, wishes you all the best, walks away as the animals and the trees move and welcome him back. That is our send-off for Garrick, and we will now take a 5-minute break. Awesome.
Very nice.
Almost had me in tears right there.
Emotional times. Ugh. Yeah.
Oh, man.
Now you can leave it in. Because this is taking place before this yesterday's episode, right?
Yes.
We're in the past a little bit.
You're in the past a little bit.
Okay.
You guys are in the past right now.
That's what I figured. I'm like, uh-oh.
Back up.
I saw that. I'm like...
As Nihilus is leaving the army with a fresh set of weaponry, and he meets back up with the party, and they're on the third floor of the castle, and they winding staircase, a smaller staircase than the grand one that they were in with the heart. And they enter a room, and through some of the windows they can hear the wind whistling outside. And they realize that you can see that Nihilus Ellen just walked into a room. He shows up. And it is a 30 by 30 round room. There's a wall, almost like circular room, and then the back wall is flat. And there are all these meticulous potions set up wherever you look. And it seems to be empty, but moments from walking in, Fate is ahead of you, and he goes, Ladies. And then, oh, it's just you, Fate. Oh, what have you brought us? Why have you? And you hear these, the cackling of these women, and their voice seem to throw from different corners of the room, and slowly but surely, three hags step forth, standing in different corners. All of them starting a sentence and completing it with another one of them. Sometimes all of them, sometimes just two of them.
What is going on here? What do you have? Oh, they're quite pretty. I like his wings.
Yes, ladies. Well, we're actually here to change some of that. I'll let them explain what they need, and maybe you can help. We would, Lord Strahd would appreciate if you treat them as the best as guests of the house.
Lord Strahd, he's so handsome. He knows we'll treat him well.
And so, there you all are. What might you say or do?
I appreciate your attention, ladies. I think my companion and I are looking for your help to look more like our old selves.
Old selves, what?
One of them comes up to you. One of the eyes is kind of closed, and the other one looks a bit glass. You wonder how she can even see through either one. She touches your face. Just,
why would you want to change such perfection?
I was feeling people would know me.
Oh.
I look like this.
Disguising yourself is what you would want.
And this one, she looks over at Nihilus. Sisters, what do you think?
Oh, his perfume is magnificent.
Yes. And then the one that's looking at Ellen's face, he goes, look at his eyes. Have you ever seen the yellow like that?
I don't think I've seen my own eyes by this point, so.
Oh, my boy, they are yellow. There's nothing more beautiful than, well, maybe Strahd's blue eyes. Yeah, yes, yes, they're nice. But that yellow look suits you. What do you guys like done?
Well, like I was saying, I would want to look the way I did before. So perhaps the gray eyes and not glowing so much. Mm. Just looking like a normal half-elf eyes.
You want to look like a regular human? Like a half-elf, like what you were?
Again, to appear as I did before, so that people will know me.
You shouldn't have such negative perceptions of yourself. Body image is very important. You should embrace who you are these days. Love yourself.
We appear a bit different. It's not us. Lord Strahd has requested this.
Fair enough. And she kind of goes over and, oh, these are fine robes. Very, very nice. Like, rubbing all. All right. Well, so what do we need changed? And she goes, starts looking over on her shelves, and other sisters go looking, and she goes, we're going to change them around. So it's like, I have new stuff. Get a couple of those frog legs up there. And they start pulling things down and gathering them and throwing them in the cauldron. Every time they throw them, big poofs of smoke go up. Ah, and you are a handsome fellow. Kind of look like Strahd himself there for a second. I thought he might have, but then I noticed you dressed a little different. Not quite from around here in Barovia, right? She's looking at Kreas.
And so when you see Kreas, he's cast Minor Illusion. So he looks exactly like Datura. Armor, like the helm thing, and then he lifts it and he goes, you think this will piss them off?
You're saying this to your party? Or to the witches.
And oh,
I appreciate the irony, yes.
I see you've also found some hags.
So you're literally, so you found, now here's the thing, so that means your armor, including the helmet, so you have like a kind of kind of like the beak helmet. Okay, so she looks and goes, I'll take back the comments that when she sees your face, those are the comments she gives about you, about being like Strahd. That god awful beaked armor. Yeah, that doesn't suit you, but.
No, it does not, but it's a mockery of somebody who, well, hopefully will hang from the ramparts.
If you carry on mocking. Carry on then. All right, so give me down to the T what specific changes you'd like, and we'll make it happen. Now, just we'd also like to make sure you know, so that you don't blame us for anything. I would not want Strahd's retribution coming down on us. And she says, I just have this little, she pulls out a parchment of paper and an ink quill, and it's already laid out. She says, she hands it over to one, to Nihilus, one to Ellen. Just in the chance that anything goes wrong and you come out worse than you did before, maybe lumps or hunchbacked, possibly a toad, you cannot blame us for this.
Oh.
Just sign. I'll just sign right there. And another sister's like, you just sign right there.
And can I read this contract?
Oh, yeah, sure. And it like, for the most part, it's like line by line. It's just like the witches of Ravenloft take no responsibility towards any accidents, mishaps, repercussions that come from spell casting or cauldron issues. And then it's not a lot, a whole lot, but she's just like, and she just asked you to sign it. So it's not like a whole lot of fine print, not a devilish contract or anything like that. But she just, you just need to cover ourselves. We don't want to end up with our heads on a pike or, you know.
We realize Strahd sent us down here to have this done, or Strahd sent us here to have this done.
I understand. Strahd orders a lot of things, and he also sometimes acts like he forgets. Oh, did I say that? Don't say that, sister. I'm sorry, I didn't say that. You didn't hear that.
I'm just saying, even if we sign this, Strahd may hold you accountable for what happens.
You're right.
He doesn't seem like the type to care about the contract that I signed.
Can I have a persuasion check or intimidation check, depending on how I hear you? I'm hearing persuasion, but...
Persuasion. I think they're...
Yeah.
Are they the same? No, they're the same.
Yeah, they're charisma-based, so that'd be the same. Just
okay. That's an 8.
Okay.
Wow.
He rolled for her. She's not... She kind of looks at you. She's like...
You make a good point, but... Strahd likes things also done in order, and I'm sure he'd expect that we give him that you've signed.
She holds it up.
If I take the contract, do I sense anything magical about it?
Do you have, unless you're casting detect magic or anything like that, or you just that. Okay?
Okay.
Can you give me an insight check for both of you, including Krius, who's just standing there watching? Yeah.
Even if I do cast the detect magic.
So sorry.
Even if I cast
it, if you cast it, you can cast detect magic if you like. Are you doing that?
Yes, sir.
And so you detect all this magic throughout the room, and you do detect a you detect magic throughout the room, but you don't detect any magic on the paper or the pen.
Contract seems mundane, Ellen.
All right.
Like I said, it's just paperwork for the master.
Yeah. I'll scrawl my name on the bottom.
Put it this way, the master even has an accountant who's still here, and I don't know what he's accounting.
It's a big castle. A lot to keep track of.
Yes, yes, yes.
I'm sorry, did I hear that correctly? The count has an accountant?
Accountant. That he does.
Strahd is not without great irony. And dear sisters, if I may ask a question of you, how good are you at making poisons?
Oh, well, we've got poisons already made. Do you have anything to give for it? I know you're guessing all, but Strahd doesn't say we have to give away our poison.
You're looking for gold?
Ah, money.
Or do you want things?
We like things. What do you have that we could maybe keep or use? Anything you've collected? Any corpses, carcasses, eyes? Anything interesting?
And he doesn't have anything else on him from when he first... He's like, unfortunately, then no, I have nothing to trade at this time.
We have wolf skins that served us on the mountain, but it's a bit warm even for here.
We could get wolves any day.
I suppose you could.
Wolves. Unless maybe... We can fix you, but maybe we could... Could we have the skin that we repair on your face? Maybe take the... I would take that and... I don't know what we would take from the one with no eyes. No? Yeah, just...
I mean, I have extra fingers on my hands. You can have the extra fingers.
That! Now that, ladies... She moves away from Ellen. She goes, oh, yes, we could totally use these talons, these appendages that work perfect in the potion, the thing that we do. Yeah, every year. Summon it. We'll take those. We'll make sure you guys are well. And excellent. And so we'll give you, for those, how many potions are you looking for? Potions of poison? Each post has about 4 doses, so, I mean, I don't plan on poisoning the village, do you?
Not today.
Just something strong enough to get rid of a fey creature.
1 for each finger should do it. Now, these are really strong. Really strong.
So nod to Krius.
All right, Krius, well, you might can wait close by as he, the two sisters go in the back and there's like a door on the side towards that flat wall and they come out with these two kind of elongated, like doctor-like beds and they ask Ellen and Nihilus to lie on them. And then, I don't know if you guys, so they're like waiting for you.
Sure, yeah.
Make yourself comfortable. It's a bit, the linens are like drenched in like dry spotty red stains, as you burgundy stains that you would imagine are probably blood. Don't worry, those weren't for you. Those are people that didn't make it back. And then the main one stands over both of you and starts to go, sleep. Now listen, you to me. You need to listen. You need to listen. You need to sleep. Now, don't fail on this part, or it's going to be a painful surgery, and I need you to sleep. Constitution saves from both of you.
15.
Mel.
Yep.
We can't be put to sleep.
Oh, no. Neither one of you? Or just...
You're right. Neither of us can be put to sleep by magic. Oh,
God, I never knew it'd come back to bite me.
It never helps, and now it's hurting us.
And so, like, she's doing it, she's like, she's starting to realize you won't sleep, and she goes, oh bloody hell. Krius, are you going to want to sit around and watch this? Because it's not going to feel good.
Oh, definitely.
And so then we just cut to just, like, you guys screaming, like, as they, like, saw and, like, pull and pluck and push and prod at your body.
I didn't realize that was attached to that part.
And so the camera kind of pans up towards the ceiling, and we like
kind of like blood
splatters
on the
walls. And they constantly like giggle as they do, and we kind of fade to like 2 hours later, as you, Krius, you're standing out on that kind of that parapet on the skies as. Ellen and Nihilus kind of come limping out in utter agony and pain. And you guys are all bandaged up. But what we can see is that Nihilus has a set of eyes. One is green, one is blue. It's just like they just installed some random eyes in his skull. and we see that Ellen is kind of wrapped around the same way. They've kind of like wrapped her. He has one, you can only see one eye. And so the side that was slack is the one that's wrapped up. And there's a little, it's spotty.
I did specify that I wanted my eyes back the way they were. Like I have gray eyes.
Yeah, and you have gray eyes. So the eye that we can see is gray. So things did work, it appears. But because of the agony, you all have two levels of exhaustion right now. You have been around almost 8 hours now in Ravenloft, so I will say that you've taken your long rest, but you still have these two levels of exhaustion right now, and that does not feel good.
Right.
Because of that. And so that does not make you feel good about any impending doom of everything coming to Ravenloft. Nope. And you meet Kreis there.
So did we get a long rest first and then get exhausted? Yes,
you got the long. So yeah. Here's the thing. Here's what I'll say. Give me another constitution save.
Okay.
This one's going to be a DC 16.
It is exactly 16.
Nice. So
is my con negative? No, I'm good.
Good.
Yes, I beat it.
Okay. So you guys have taken your long rest. And you still have one level of exhaustion from that, like the torturous surgery that you just went through. So it's pretty much skill checks are a disadvantage right now, right?
Golly, Mal.
Final battle, you give us this.
I thought you guys were gonna go to sleep. I didn't know. So now, Kreis, what do you say to them as they come limping and hobbling out before you?
Ellen, you looked like my grand uncle before he had his ear replaced. And Nihlus, I'm enjoying the new set of eyes. You remind me of someone we knew in Eberron called the Thin White Duke. He also had similar eyes. We also called him the Star Man. Mostly because he drank so much, wound up on the floor of a tavern and saw stars, but that's a much different story for a different time.
Now this is pouring himself wine out of his alchemy jug. He's trying to get over this.
All right, I'm sorry. I got to take another 2-minute break. I just got to do something really quick. So you can feel free to just hang out. I'm coming right back.
Wow.
If I knew that was coming, I would have to ask for the change.
I would say no. I could just disguise myself. It's not that big of a deal. I can wear some flowers. Yeah. I can use perfume.
You're not stinky anymore.
I can run a hot spring. You know, like there's things I could do.
I just know that's gonna come back to bite us.
Fully. I was looking at it and I was like, damn it. Like as soon as he was like, oh, I'm trying to put you to sleep, I was like, I don't know if that's gonna work. I looked, I was like, nope.
Yeah.
I usually ignore those two little A's that I have under my thing. They don't usually come.
They don't ever get become relevant. And they're supposed to be good.
Well, yeah. Well, I mean, I guess if you're low level and someone casts sleep on you, that helps. Yeah. But like,
but not
usually we're the ones casting
not sleep before a big battle. Not like that.
Okay. Well, let's just try not to do any ability checks, apparently. Or let Kreis do it.
Shoot, at least our speed isn't halved.
Yeah.
That would have been real bad. And even then, like, even if it was a charm and like you wanted to like fail and like he allowed us to, I can't be charmed because of one of my gifts.
Oh yeah.
I literally cannot be charmed.
I can't be charmed either. It's yeah.
Now this era Ellen has advantage.
Yeah. That helps. And well, at least I have. Well, that's a constitution saving throw. It's going to be different.
Against being charmed?
I do have Warcaster, so.
Yeah, so that gives you advantage on con saves. It's huge. A lot of people think that Warcaster is... Technically, it depends. If you're going to play a low-level campaign, Warcaster is key. Mm-hmm. High-level campaign, sometimes proficiency con is better.
Yeah.
But yeah, the advantage is clutch.
And I have one of my cantrips is a melee spell attack, so I can also it's not even that. Like Warcaster, you can cast a spell if someone doesn't attack it or like provokes an attack of opportunity.
Yep. So
I can fucking lightning bolt them if they do that.
Yeah. Eldritch Blast for me.
Eldritch Blast for days.
Cannot waste spell slots on nonsense. Like opportunity attacks.
But there could be
two more.
Like you could have reasons to use that. I don't know if you have banishment, but that could be pretty clutch. Well, but we're in Barovia.
I didn't take it because we were in Barovia and I was metagaming.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do have, so because of the switch, right? I do have spike growth. And I did get summon Fae.
Nice.
So, interesting. Yeah.
Yeah. No, my spells are interesting. I can only cast twice. That's the real problem. But I can cast Fairy Fire once, just because I'm a drow.
Yep.
I think it's always interesting. Every time I take a break, I walk out of my room. And my wife is always downstairs, and no matter what, like I crack the door, and she always goes, "Mal." And I'm like, yeah, like
who else would it be
up here? And she's like, and today I literally asked, I go, who else would it be? Like you ask every time I leave the room, and she goes, a ghost? And I'm like, okay, well, yeah I guess.
Well, do you not have the Morkborg book in your bedroom?
Sometimes I do. Yeah, I probably shouldn't.
It's right beside my bed. Like my kids are just like, oh, that's the daddy scary book. Like we don't go by that one.
Man, Henry had me last night having heart palpitations in that game. I was like, dude, this is too much. Stop.
I so wanted to play. It's just my kids had had it. It was.
And let me know if I've ever made you guys feel that, because I that's the first time in a game where I felt no choice was a good choice. There were like no good choices. It was just like, I just wanted to run back to the front of the dungeon and get out. Like I knew that there was like every choice we made seemed like,
except that there are bird tentacle creatures there that are gonna eat you instead.
And then I was hoping he was gonna like give us like some reprieve on that, and sure enough there was an eye there. I was like, oh my god, I just knew I was gonna die. But somehow another one that we made through made it through that game. So
yeah.
And on top of that, there's the pre-order for that that zine, and then they did a second one that's coming out too, and I'm like,
it's a popular game, people love it. I will say, like, it's part of the whole OSR revival, or what do you call it, original, what does the OSR stand for? Jeez, I can't even remember right now. Original something renaissance, but it's pretty much like old D&D rules. Kind of like tapping into like what old advanced
old school revival, or old school renaissance, one of the two.
Yep, it's revival.
Yeah.
You got it. But yeah, they're really cool. I like that. Like even if it wasn't as dark, I just like the level of just how quick Morkborg plays. You know, it kind of lends itself to a lot of times to the way we play D&D, you know, with very much role playing at the forefront, like what we've rolled 3 dice or 4 dice checks today, but you guys are probably fine with that, whereas it's probably a lot of people are like, why aren't we making dice checks, you know? So it just depends on what you like.
I think a drawback for me with Morkborg, not anything to do with the setting, but the fact that we did character creation at the table meant that I wasn't able to like take time to get into character.
Yes.
And that was a little difficult for me.
It's difficult if you're not, yeah. And it's a good game to play every now and then to kind of stretch your imagination muscles and try to figure out who this character is. Cause like, yeah, we were all making our characters up at that table, trying to figure them out. And there are classes though. So once you've played the game a couple times, you still roll stats at the table, but you can know what you're going to be. Like, so I've played like a werebear before, so I kind of was able to already know a little bit about the character, but then the stats kind of had to roll those out and go with the flow. So yeah, you're right. Yeah. It is one of those where it is a little more difficult from that standpoint. But it also, sometimes that makes for, like, one of our games was really amazing, and it just came from Eric's is the only character that survived, but
oh yeah, that was when I was
that
in.
Was really cool, and like he made that character and all that happened at the table. It was kind of like, wow, how do we do that, you know?
I try to play because I mean we did it right then and there, so I just try to play in mine as if, like, you know, just like a crustier version of Peter Stormare, like, you know, from like Nacho Libre, like, you the egg, and it was nasty because he's chewing bugs the whole time.
Yes. So. Yeah, that was your thing. You would chew the bugs. I think the worst Ellen had character. I mean, Colin's character had like a bug in his hair. Like he was like eating at least bugs one roach, the entire. Yeah. I got to get Jason on a workboard game. Jason, say, tell me this: Have you ever watched?
Really hates me. They hates me, bro. I've been waiting for my book to get here. I ordered it the week before Christmas.
Wow. Dude, that's ridiculous.
I don't know. They just don't like me.
Have you
told me it was going to arrive before the game, and it didn't come until like a week and a half after. No. It did, but it didn't make it the game that I played with you all that first.
That's why I hate to say it. I don't like saying it, but I order everything from Amazon because it comes in like 2 days. It comes within like 24 hours.
I did order from Amazon. Okay. And so they lost it, and then they're just like, okay, so here's your option order. I'm like, yes, and that one came the next day after the game. I'm like.
See, I was trying to be nice and actually order from them.
Actual company.
Read it in Dutch or something. Like, I was like, translate the page.
Everything I order from a company these days, and I feel bad because I'm like, Amazon is slowly that reach is it's like slowly closing in. But like, I ordered an apron for my wife. It came like 6 weeks later. It was supposed to come before Christmas. Like, and then not only did it come 6 weeks later, and I ordered it from a reputable company. What's that? William Sonoma apron. I'm thinking that's going to come on time. It doesn't come on time. Not only does it not come on time, they charge my account three times on accident. And then it just makes you kind of want to be like, do you want us to just go to the all evil, like, you know, all worship Amazon? Because, like, they never, they, like, always get it right. Or if they don't get it right, you call them, they're like, they fix it, and then there it is. Yeah. But, yeah, I've been having, like, I have stuff that I've ordered from the actual companies that I'm still waiting on.
That's the thing with Amazon is they figured out the supply chain.
Oh, my
God. As long as you're getting it from Amazon and not from a third-party seller, it works.
They've dialed that shit in.
I mean, at one point, we're just going to be all outside, you know, Jeff Bezos' place going, Jeff Bezos.
Yeah. it's quite weird.
It can be unsettling, yeah.
All right. So we will pick back up there on the...
Oh, Mal, what happened to my wings?
Your wings, since you didn't ask them to do anything much with them, they made them, they broke them and they worked them so they're more compact. So now you can fit them under a robe and no one would ever know they were there. So they double fold. Whereas they would normally sit like right here, they like fold down a second time. And then so you can like.
They gave me the Lambo suicide wings.
So like they'll just rip out of your. So if you were like in a bar drinking, you could just like, you know, tear them out the back, and people would never see them coming. Yep. So you now have a set of eyes. We haven't removed the bandages, but hopefully Ellen's face is restored. That smell is gone. Thankfully from Nihilus.
The question all is, of where your did
powers
it go?
Remain. Right now.
Got it. Okay.
Oh, in retrospect, that would have been nice. Like, can you keep the smell and
bottle it up?
Keep it for a potion? Sorry.
They probably kept that smell. They probably scraped every little bit of it.
And Kreas has two poison potions. Yep.
Nalus will disguise self so that he looks like himself and not like this crazy cat.
Okay.
But you don't like the eyes?
No, I'm a little jealous. My eyes are, Nalus's eyes are also gray. So the fact that he got his eyes back and Nalus did it is kind of annoying him.
He had eyes to begin with. Maybe they just need to change the color for you. They just had to plot to just find eyes out of jars and put them in, but they probably could have done a little work to change the color. So the thing is now, hopefully if this all works, you still look like Nihilus, you just have the different colors, but you can always use your disguise self to just change the colors of the eyes.
Yeah, that's what I just did right now, yeah, because we're all good.
And so there you are standing on that kind of, almost like this is probably not where you, but you know, several floors down, and that level is right, it's probably around this level. And it's right outside on a walkway. If I had to build it, there's like a walkway that leads to where the heart is, and you all are there right now. Because there's another area over here that leads to where the witches were. But now you're kind of just standing there taking in the. It's not much to see because there's so much mist and rain kind of pouring down around Ravenloft. And there's kind of a what next until Strahd actually calls on you.
So did Nihilus and Ellen see the heart when they came in?
It was the first thing we saw.
They did.
Much.
So yeah, that's a so this might be new for you, but like you hear that boom, boom, kind of beating inside this inside that hall. And it's also where Strahd is performing the ritual up there at the top. Channeling that the energy, and so I imagine that Ellen and Nihilus are going to tell you. So what you would learn is that Strahd has used the three seeds of Barovia, which are the gems, the ones that were buried under the ground of the winery, that were the only thing that was giving the land life. And he's like, you guys were only using it for wine. He's using it to channel that energy into the heart. The heart is Strahd hasn't really, you guys haven't really asked him much about it. But he does mention it as being the heart of Ravenloft, and using that to channel his spell, allowing him to almost like you get a feeling that it's like a giant plane shift spell, but basically he's trying to take the whole fucking castle with him. Like he doesn't want to leave any of his shit behind. And this is the long drawn out way of doing it. And also the Wand of Orcus allows him to. The Wand of Orcus is so powerful, Strahd sees it as a way to challenge because the dark forces keep the demiplane in control, but if you can control the dark forces, then you can tear a hole open with just enough time to exit. So you all get the feeling that that's what this whole dramatic ritual that Strahd is up there working on is to just get the hell out of Dodge.
Okay. Well, fellas, if we have some time, do you want to go exploring?
What is that sound?
It's the heart, the castle. Sorry, we saw it pretty much the first thing. I imagine we'll see it again as we go back up to Strahd, but it's a huge crystalline heart that's beating. Don't really know what it normally does.
Ellen, where I come from, red crystals are very, very, very bad. Do you remember what I was feeding to Quake? They power weapons of destruction. I'm going to assume that it must do the same.
I don't know any. I don't have any knowledge of that. But I will trust you.
I'm hoping you're right. We're going to need something like that to go against a dragon and a demon lord.
So what shall we do?
Well, it would do good to know the layout of the castle if we're going to be fighting here. I guess it may not be important, but I'd heard that Irina was here. Kreas, I don't even know if you know who Irina is, but Strahd was obsessed with her for a while. He believes that she's the reincarnation of the woman he loved back when he was alive. But It sounds like he has believed that about a number of women throughout the ages.
Who speaks Tatiana's name? And then behind you there in the doorway, you see Strahd kind of hobble forward. I'm taking another break. What is this about, Irina?
Were you able to bring her back?
Barovia brings her back. It is part of my curse. Over and over again, I am meant to relive my passion and my love for Tatiana. And this last time, it was Irina. And again, it ended the same way it always does. In pain. And he drops his cloak back, and you can see that he's bleeding on the side. There's like a and he's kind of like clutches aside, and you can see that he's like, he'll like touch it and it heals, and then more blood continues to roll out of it after he brings his hand away. There is no time to worry about this. It will be fixed when all is done. My powers are weakened by the ritual. My brother made a blade. I thought he loved me. He kind of walks by you, stands and looks out, you know, standing on that bridge, looking out over everything. I think it is time we prepare for the coming tide. Yes, what were you going to say? Kind of for a second, he kind of goes in and out. What were you going to say, Kreas?
Lord Strahd, if we are being attacked, is there any way for the heart to be protected?
Unfortunately, no. Only I can protect it. I mean, what do you propose?
Was my ship ever brought back?
I'm glad that you brought that up. Yes, I did have it repaired. It is sitting down in the mist towards the bottom of... give me a second. Kind of sit, kind of rush down. I've been doing too much. Kind of brings his hand up. And in the down there towards the... You hear the... You hear like the crystals come to life. You hear the elemental charge. And you can tell that it's like slowly lifting and on its way to you. Yes, you do have your ship. What do you want to do with it, Kreas?
There's two ideas, Lord Strahd. One, there's an elemental that runs it. If Ellen can control it, perhaps we can secure the heart that way. Two, we use it against Argonboss.
Tell me more about using the elemental to secure the heart.
We would have to destroy the rings around and release the elemental, and if we can control and contain it, it would protect the heart while you're casting whatever it is you will do.
You're hoping that an elemental will protect it and not damage it. With the elemental free, believe me, I have my understanding of these spirits, it might become, and actually remind me what type of elemental is in the ship that you flew. Is it fire? Is it wind?
It's an air elemental.
whipping air. So we could... That could work. I could channel the wind from the elemental. Have my witches help me focus on that. The wind could pull through the tower, causing those that approach to ever so lightly be blown off their platform.
It's a long way down.
It is a long way down. Those who cannot fly, I wonder if they will bounce.
So long as one who looks like this, and he puts down the helm and it looks like Datura.
So he long like as grimaces this one, at it with his fangs out.
So long as this one bounces many, many, many a time, and he puts it back up.
Don't worry, that one is no... I've got something as well for that one.
Very well.
What you expect of me, Kreas? I can speak to this elemental. I don't have a spell necessarily that can bind it unless I'm just going to beat it into submission.
Ah, Ellen, the binding is already a part of the ship. Near the control room, there is a box, and within that box is a set of runes. Those runes keep the elemental bound. Wherever those runes go, the elemental must follow.
I like this plan. I like you, Kreas. And you, Nihilus and Ellen. Probably the longest living heroes, adventurers who've come through these lands. You all give me hope, make me feel like my old self. Anything else? Any other ideas while we ponder? He kind of seems to pace as though he's just listening to you all.
Are there any ballista? Are there any projectiles that we can use for Argenbost? He will come and he will land.
The ship kind of blow, the mist begins to part and the ship rises out, and it's like it's right there between those two towers you guys are standing. It's like hovering there. Let's talk and take a ride. And the little lattice or the boarding just opens up and like and lands right there on that stone walkway, and Strahd walks up and is standing now on the bow or the deck of the ship and invites you all on. And as you guys step on, and there is probably another good 40 minutes of travel, as you don't know where Strahd is taking you, but you see yourselves kind of drifting away from Ravenloft and heading, and everything you see over through the mist down below, you can see the small town, not Valaki, but the small little town of Barovia. You can see those woods, and you can see that winding road that both Nihilus and Ellen remember walking in, or stumbling, however they stumbled into Ravenloft on. And while you travel, I'll turn it over to you all and Strahd kind of stands at the helm, and the wheel just moves on its own, as though Strahd is mage handing it.
It is a beautiful place.
I am going to miss this land.
Ellen, you were saying?
I'm setting us something up, so go ahead, continue on while I...
You may want to show me these runes so I can familiarize myself with them.
So I guess he would walk you into the control room right behind the wheel, and as he opens up the panel, it's going to be in a small little, it almost looks like a 45 degree angle, right? Almost like a half triangle. And there you see the runes just just glowing bright, bright blue.
Is that panel integrated into the ship, or is it something that can be removed?
It can be removed, Nihilus.
Seems like it could be useful. Does the ship have any weaponry?
Unless Strahd repaired everything, it may not be any.
Grasping at straws here. Not sure how excited I am to clash with these foes.
My only other idea takes us in a completely different direction, so I don't know if it's a good one. But I'll share it anyway. Strahd shared that Argonwasp and Silver Dragons in general were connected with humans. So what if, and it seems like a lot of people are already coming to Ravenloft, but what if we could lead Argonwasp away to protect Barovia or Valaki?
Are you recommending that we poison a village?
We've got some fireballs, don't you?
Set them on fire.
I do.
Strahd had, well, I don't know this. Never mind. Nihilus. Take that back.
You know that Strahd has some fireballs. We've seen it.
It's fireballs, yeah. I was going to say something else, but I didn't know that. Oh, so I keep my mouth shut.
Death from above.
I don't know that it makes sense to split our forces, but it certainly didn't help the Last Feathers party to gather all their enemies to attack them at once. Do you think we could, if we could lead Argonwasp away, create a situation where only he can respond? Take him out? Or is that too ambitious?
He's a realistic dragon.
It's a possibility.
It's risky.
Say that one more time, your plan that you were just mentioning.
I was saying it's a bad idea, but I was going to share it anyway because it's my only idea. That Strahd.
God damn it. Strahd lost a hand. I got to.
Oh, no.
His whole hand is gone.
It'll regrow. It's no big deal.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's supposed to be like this. He's like, oh, it's just, now just like.
It's just a short rest.
God damn it.
So, yeah, Malcolm, you such may bad have to luck step with in hands. Again. And, if we actually do this, you may have to step in and take it out of the recording. But I was saying, try to capitalize off of Argonwasp's nature. What if we could lead him away to protect somebody who isn't fighting, to split their forces? Because Argonwasp feels connected to people.
Mm-hmm.
All of the people who can fight are coming to Ravenloft.
Mm-hmm.
What if we threaten either Valaki or Barovia?
Strahd speaks up and he goes, Argonwasp loves humankind and humanoids, but he is a war general, and he most likely will stick to the plan.
He would sacrifice them.
I can't see him. I have played these games with him in the past. He did not take those tricks. But it is not worth trying. I am just letting you know, he might see it as a sacrifice. He might see it as saving many by staying on the goal to kill me. Because I'm sure I am who will be his crosshairs.
Well, as I said, it was not a good idea, but my only other alternative.
And as you guys can see there, you're bobbing above these misty clouds, and the clouds begin to part All right. This, I need you to all be prepared. And as the cloud parts, you see what you recognize is those large stone gates that you came through Barovia in, Helen. And you realize you've flown over them, and you see that kind of a wet, some parts kind of moist and some parts kind of rocky, almost like a blood stained, almost like a, what am I calling it, a crimson ground. The ground is almost reddish down below. And you recognize it as the first place that when you walked into you, Ellen, when you came in, you remember fighting Fido with that large group, with the first group there. And and the ship begins to slowly descend towards that ground. And as you are descending, Strahd kind of materializes almost like under his cloak, several treasures. The first one he hands to Nihilus, and it seems to be like a switch of some type of a wrapping of maybe 2.5 feet long, like someone took a bunch of switches and wrapped them together, very dried branches, and hands them over to you, and they seem to like seep and be stained in a bit of red blood. Take this, Nihilus. Remember, use it as the it is the last that is left of Winter Splinter, the Guthias staff. You saw him. You saw Winter Splinter born of this tree. This weapon will aid you. It is made of the branch of the Guthias tree. It is spongy, black wood. Its evil makes beasts visibly uncomfortable within 30 feet of it. And the staff has 10 charges. I will send this information to you if you need otherwise. And I'll also can put it in the chat, but it regains 1d6 plus 4 charges that it expends, regains 1d6 plus 4 of its expended charges daily at dusk. If the staff is broken, burned to ashes, its wood releases a terrible inhuman scream. Let's see what else. So what you can do with the staff is it has two things. Blightbane, where while you are attuned to the staff, blights and other evil plant creatures don't regard you as hostile. And you can use a vampiric strike with it. The staff can be wielded as a magical quarterstaff. On a hit, it deals damage as normal. And you can expend a charge to regain a number of hit points to the damage that you give. Each time the charge is spent, red blood oozes from the staff's pores. You must succeed a DC 12 wisdom save or be afflicted with a short term of madness.
Sounds fun.
Yeah. So he hands that over to you. Then to Ellen, he pulls out a rod. And if you're looking at Roll 20, I don't know if you can see it here. Actually, you see that? The blood sphere? Yeah. So what he provides you with is, he tells you that a ruthless chieftain of a tribe in the Balaloc Mountains once used this. It will aid you. And so this staff will provide you with, pretty much has a, I was just looking at it. Okay, so when you hit with a melee attack with this staff, this magic spear, and reduce a target to 0 hit points, you gain 2d6 temporary hit points from whoever you kill with it. So he gives you the blood spear. And so slowly but surely the ship begins to land. He hasn't pulled out a third weapon for Kreis yet. Kreis, are you there? I want to make sure you're not away.
He said he was going to be right back.
Oh, okay, then I'll wait. Yep.
Yeah.
We'll just kind of hang out. So we'll let you guys talk about your weapons you just received.
Interesting. I may come in handy. Nihilus observes the blood spilling out of the staff. He's like, not quite the most cleanly of weapons, but hopefully it'll serve me well. Thank you, Lord Strahd. Looks like Kreas has returned.
I was checking the runes.
Nice. And so as the ship lands and gets closer down into that valley where Ellen first came into, there's a mist ahead about 30, 40 feet off, and then there's a bit of light kind of like emitting from it. Strahd just floats down, or, you know, kind of mists down, turns to bats. The rest of you either, you know, fly down or repel as he stands there with you in the valley. And so I hope those will help you. Kreas, I think you missed the weapons that were given out, or did you hear some of that or any of those?
I heard up to what Ellen had.
Okay. So I think Nihilus got the, okay, so you, that means you got both. You heard, so he got the vampire, Ellen got the Guthius staff, and then he's got this spear. Ellen's got the spear, the blood spear, that when you kill someone gives, when they reserve to zero, they get 2d6 health back. And then they both have kind of very vampiric traits. So standing there, kind of looks around and goes, you're probably wondering why I brought you all here. He looks off into the mist, his eyes begin to water. And Strahd, like, is actually showing his, like, weakness, I think, for the one of the first times. I mean, she's starting to show it, I think, over the past, you know, times that you've been with him. And he goes, I realize today that for centuries, my own foolish passions have kept me doomed to repeat my past mistakes. Today, I move forward, no looking back. And he says, I would be lying to you both, Ellen and Nihilus, to continue to tell you that your freedom hinges on defending my castle. For the first time in all my rule of Barovia, I actually see two souls worthy, three actually, but two worthy of leaving this domain. I have always had the power to let you go. My Vistani walk through the mist as they please. And so, Ellen, Nihilus, you deserve this for all that you have been through. I am Strahd von Zarovich, master of Barovia, now master over life and death, and I give you your freedom. Walk through those mists and take my gifts and bring whatever world you go to, my hell or my blessing. Kreas and I will stay here and finish this as we shall. Kreas, you also have an out here, unless you really want this land.
And for the first time, you see him in just the black armor that he's taken, right? He turns off minor illusion, and he kneels, and he looks up at Strahd, and he goes, Lord Strahd, I have no intention of going back home. There is nothing there. And if my two companions wish to leave, it was what I had promised them as well. I'm not from here, but I have new scores to settle here. My blade is yours.
And he turns, and as he as you rise, as you can see, he steps back, stands beside Prius.
This is what you wanted. This is what I grant you. From today, you know I am a man of my word. Who knows what happens from here going forward? This is no test. I just know that I, Strahd von Zarovich, gave you your freedom. Are you looking a gift horse in the mouth? What? Is this not what you wanted?
I'm looking long and hard in both directions. So DM, if I look into the mists,
yep.
Can I tell at all if it would lead into the Shadowfell or into the material plane?
Give me an insight check.
Perhaps white's better.
11.
Why do you stare so hard into the mist, Ellen?
And you can't seem to see what's beyond there.
I think you suspect. This entire time, all I've wanted to do was go home.
You served me well. You delivered my wand, did you not?
I did.
Have I lied to you until this moment? What do I get by sending you into another trap? I am sending you home, Ellen. I am sending you, and he goes, remove your bandages, both of you.
And as you start to kind of unwrap them, sure enough, as you both look whole, you still have your powers, you still have what was granted to you from the Amber Temple.
I am sending you home whole. Because if I fail, I at least know there's someone out there that I gifted. I live on no matter what.
They regret this, but part of why I chose to follow you was because I hate to see a creature imprisoned. And in you, I do see a creature in a cage. This isn't over yet. I'm not going to leave yet. Nihilus, though, I know you feel obligated to stay with me, but you're whole again. You can go serve and have your life. Don't feel the need to stay.
Ellen, let me let you know this. Don't do this for me. I am a master of my domain. I am always several steps ahead of my enemies and possibly even my allies. If you stay, I have seen several outcomes of this. And if you stay, you risk being in this prison like me. Forever. This is your chance. I can only give it to you now, this one time. Take your power, take your magic, and deliver it to any of those outside of these walls who have wronged me but you, I will not stop you from staying. Though I question whether it being the right decision for you.
Krius is right. There's still scores to settle. I'm not leaving.
Okay. And he walks over. Nihilus.
You're still on mute, Nihilus, sir.
And then he just whips his head back and goes, Ellen, these scores you have to settle. What if I told you they weren't here in Barovia? Eldith, Ellen. Eldith is no longer here. I have her corpse. But when I brought Fate back, I saw it. The sliver, the soul, should have been trapped inside. I should have been able to see Fate being tormented inside my butler for all ages. But that Fate Argo that is walking you through the halls is not Fate. He is just the demon that I brought back. I am still Strahd trapped in this demon body. I know that the Raven Queen has been tampering. Eldith is beyond that mist. So I say, if you still stay here, then let us get back to business. But you may not. This may be your last chance to confront your past.
I wouldn't be able to face the people back there if I didn't stay. I'm doing this.
I will not try to convince you any longer. Ellen, you will stay. There is much to be done back at the castle. Nihilus, if you need to go, please feel free to move beyond these clouds. And suddenly, Nihilus, you hear a bit of a whisper. It's like, you still haven't gotten that staff. But. And you feel the presence of like Melchizedek almost like creeping around your shoulders. I know that you can't take him by yourself. And let's face it. We got a good deal out of this. We're going back into the world with a great deal of information, and I could do with that. The Wand of Orcus isn't as important here. Let's continue our travels. Let's read some more books. Maybe we'll catch this thing when this guy's dead. Do you really want to stay here?
He is planning to come to the material plane, yes.
He is. It's his
plan. Maybe we'll catch him on the other side?
I think we can plan for that. We can be better prepared for him.
Nihilus will look at Ellen and say, I'm sorry, I think I have a date with a couple dwarves. But if you'd like, I'll wait for you.
I'll see you on the other side.
Nihilus, keep the bodies warm for us. We'll go hunting when we're done with this.
Nihilus will give double predator handshakes, one to each side, bow to Strahd, and he'll walk off.
I also do want to, gonna pull some bullshit here. Okay. Want to use subtle spell and use the cantrip message to Krius. So I can cast this without verbal or somatic components. Mm-hmm. I want to say to him, you're planning to unleash the elemental on the heart, aren't you?
Well, never looked a gift horse in the mouth.
And besides, Strahd thinks he's smarter than he really is. Like I said, where I come from, there is only war. And Alan, when this is all through, we'll catch up with Nihlus and we will go hunting dwarves.
So Strahd is standing ahead. You guys are having that conversation mentally. Strahd's kind of standing at the forefront as Nihlus walks through the mist. He kind of gives him a bow, and Nihlus disappears. You can kind of tell that Strahd is crying. Maybe not crying because of Nihlus, because of other things that have transpired today. And it's kind of hit him in a bit of a soft spot. He turns.
Well, enough of that. His claws kind of grow. He goes, you're all committed then. From here on out, let's go pluck the feathers off the rest of the birds that will be arriving shortly. And he blimp bamps up to the top of the ship and waits for you all as it begins to take off and usher itself back towards Ravenloft. As it does that, I'd like to hear from Nihlus last remarks from Ellen and Kreas.
That was a really difficult decision. Ellen did expect Strahd possibly to stab him in the back if he walked away. But he also is being completely genuine that there are still scores to settle with many people. And he was being genuine in saying part of why he stayed is Strahd is a beast in a cage, and he doesn't like seeing that. That doesn't mean that he wants to set Strahd free.
Reese is just running through the different variations of the battle in his mind, seeing what they can do, and then trying to envision he and Ellen walking through the mists and going with Nihlus and hunting some dwarves.
Nice. And then we fade away from those remarks. You're just walking through mists right now, all by yourself, all alone, Nihlus. Malkazit even goes quiet. It's just you, and it seems like you're walking for, it seems like miles, just through mists blindly. What are you thinking about? Or
to the mist.
Yeah. What's your last?
Me?
Is there anything
he's
that
you're definitely hurt? Like leaving Ellen back there was probably the hardest thing he's ever done. But one, there's a couple dwarves that have something coming to him, and if they're free, he needs the plan. And two, that's a scary fight, and he wasn't looking forward to it anyway, so he's a little relieved. It's conflicted emotions.
And so
excitement.
Yeah. And as he continues to walk through that mist, up ahead, he starts to see a light, and that mist begins to part. And from what he can see, it almost looks like it could be the light from the sun of the breaking day. He feels a bit of the warmth. And we'll crash to black there and end today's episode. Good game.
Nice.
Breaks me hard. I could have just walked away.
You really could.
That's what I put in the chat. I'm like, just go.
No. Because I end up having watched that last episode, with the people, like, with fate just bamfing back in, like, I couldn't face those people if I just said, I quit. Sorry.
I was hoping you wouldn't go off of that. I wanted you to go off of it. Like, Ellen is the wanted freedom. That's all you've ever wanted. I was like, take it.
Yeah.
Oh, man. I know it's hard. Yeah.
It's hard.
I really don't want to walk away, but Nihilus wouldn't abstain. Like, if there's an opportunity.
That's pretty much what he was giving your weapons is like to go out into the real world. And my whole goal is like to have seem like Strahd was setting you up. No, he's just giving you something like a parting gift.
Damn quarterstaff.
It's like a parting staff.
I was like, cool.
You can't use any weapons? You can't use a quarterstaff as a weapon?
It's a simple weapon, so I'm proficient with it, but it's a strength-based weapon.
It's like one of those things. It's like, come to Castle Ravenloft, and when you leave, don't forget your parting gifts.
Don't forget your parting gift.
You know?
They are magical weapons from this world. So like they're like, actually the blood spear when you guys first went to, it was hidden amongst the rocks when you went and the druids all came out, where the Strahd thing was standing. If you guys would have investigated, you would have found it. It was there. The Guthias staff was in the tree. There was just never any like investigating. Yeah, that's cool. But they were lying around.
We wanted to investigate with our three levels of exhaustion. That sounded like a good idea.
Right. So it wouldn't make sense, but so yeah, you got. oh man. So this is gonna be interesting. So I'm just gonna close out so we can talk about it after this. But thanks for watching, Curse of Strahd. Interesting, no combat today, just all role play. I enjoyed the hell out of it. And we'll see what happens next. All right.